That's a little more like Jesus, a little less like me.
Oh, I have days I lose the fight. Try my best, but just don't get it right. That I don't want to miss the moments right before my eyes. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped. Somebody with a hand that I could have held. When I just can't see past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Yeah, there's no denying I have changed, 'cause I've been saved from who I used to be. Even at my best, I must confess, I still need help to see the way you see. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped. Somebody with a hand that I could have held. When I just can't see past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Oh, I want to be the beggar on the street, love to be your hands and feet, freely give what I receive, Lord, help me be. A little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me, a little more like living everything I preach, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Oh, a little less like me.
You may be seated as Tyler comes for announcements.
Good morning, Church 247. You'll bear with me this morning. I'm a little hoarse. Your elder of the week is John Brock. If you need anything, questions, comments, concerns, his phone number is in your bulletin as well as in the slideshow. Tuesday at 1 o'clock, we have weekly prayer here in the worship center. That's your first of two opportunities to pray with the church. Wednesday at 7 o'clock, the youth will not meet in the hedge. There will be no hedge on Wednesday night. Men and ladies will join in the worship center, and Kids 247 will be as scheduled.
Youth in here.
Youth will combine with the men and ladies here in the sanctuary. So youth, hedge, men and ladies, all in this room. Thursday at 6:30 is prayer circle at the camp. That's your second of two opportunities to pray with the church. Amen to the food, Friday at 7 a.m. Men's Bible study breakfast at the Grapevine on Highway 9. Sunday, July 31st at 6. Fifth Sunday night singing with Praise Team 247 and others at the church. Bring along your favorite finger food for afterwards and enjoy the fellowship. Amen to the finger foods. Looking ahead, Sunday, August 7th at 3 o'clock is a new partners class in the Gather. For anyone wanting to partner with Church 247, please see Lori Brock for more details or if you would like to attend. Saturday, August 13th at 11:30 is our next opportunity to feed the hungry. Don't forget about the Blue Bowl for the money to raise money for that event. Sunday, August 21st is Kids 247 Promotion Day and the Back to School Splash. More details to come on that, but that's always a fun day for the kids department here at Church 247. Let's stand and worship with Praise 247.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Oh,
next song is absolutely probably our favorite. It's I looked back at our schedule a couple of weeks ago, and we have sang this song more than we've sang any song. And it is so powerful because the name of Jesus is powerful. What a beautiful name it is.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation now revealed in You are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now?
What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name.
What a powerful name it is.
on that one for a long time, can't you? Will you pray with me? Father, I thank you. I thank you for this place. I thank you for this hour that we come together to worship. And in this hour, Father, we profess with our mouths what a beautiful name your Son, the Lord Jesus, is. What a powerful name. What a powerful man he was who lived and walked among us. And then he went back to heaven. And Father, you decided to send the power of your Spirit, the same power that the Lord Jesus has, the power of your Spirit to live inside of us. Wow. If you were to ask me, I would say, man, this has been a little bit of a hard week. And I picked a verse this morning. I don't usually do this, but I decided to stick it up there on the PowerPoint. I think Roger's going to show that out of Psalm 42. The Lord will send his faithful love by day. Have you experienced his faithful love by day this week? Perhaps when we've not been faithful to him, he's been faithful to us. The next part says, his song will be with me in the night. May I just candidly ask, has anyone else been awake in the night this week besides me? And when the cares of this world wake us up and jar us awake and we stare at the ceiling, has his song come to our minds in the night? And have we offered a prayer to the God of our lives? Oh God, we thank you for your faithful love in the day, and we thank you for your song in the night. We thank you, Father, that you have surrounded us with your presence. Maybe in the moment we don't feel it, we don't sense it, we don't experience it, we wonder where you are. Father, you have us surrounded in the day, and you have us surrounded in the night. We offer a prayer to you, the God of our lives. You may have seen Miss Eunice come to me. She just got a text, and it was from Miss Kathy, and she said that she's not feeling well, and she's not here at church today. And so, Father, we lift our beloved sister, Kathy Robinson, up to you. And we ask you that you raise her up, Father, to health. And then Eunice also mentioned Bootsy and her family. Bootsy is struggling with her back, and her stepfather passed away this week, and her mom is not doing very well at all. Would somebody just stand in honor of Miss Bootsy and maybe Miss Kathy? Somebody just stand on their behalf. Father, we stand symbolically today with Miss Bootsy. Lord, you know that her stepfather would pass away, and you knew that her mom would be very sick, and you knew that she would be struggling today with her back. But today, Father, we stand on her behalf, and we just hold her arms up. Father, would you help her this week? Father, may she know your faithful love in the day, and may she hear your song in the night. This week. For little Letty Burgess and for Steve Glover, Father, we hold their hands up today in prayer. Would you show them your faithful love in the day, and would you give them a song of peace, a song of hope, a song of joy in the night? And you're standing here right now. Many of you, thank you for that. On behalf of Miss Bootsy, maybe you'd want to stand in honor of someone else. Maybe you want to call a name out. Go ahead and do that.
Amen. Alan was sick this week, not here today. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Hendrix is finally in daycare. Thank you, Jesus.
Well, we just give the Lord a round of applause for that.
Samuel.
Amen.
Adam.
Amen.
John and Jacqueline.
Amen.
Sylvia Roberts.
Amen.
Betty.
Amen. Father, we thank you in the quietness of this room for your faithful love by day. Father, in the night, when the cares of this world get to us, would you give us a song? May you remind us, Father, that you are the God of all of our days. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I came to you with my heart in pieces and found the God with healing in his hands. I turned to you. All things new. I look to you, drowning in my questions, and found the God who holds all wisdom. And I trusted you and stepped out on the ocean. You caught my hand among the waves, 'cause you're the God who bondage, God, you are my freedom. reason that I sing. Cause you're the God of all my days.
Each step I take,
you make a way. Now I give you all my praise. My seasons change, you stay. God, you are my vision. In my bondage, God, you are my freedom. Oh, my days.
So next Sunday night is the 31st, and that is the night that we'll have an entire hour of that great music. Amen?
Amen.
Isn't that great? Pray for Brandon's voice. I think he went through adolescence. He's turned into a bass these last few weeks. Y'all pray for him. Man, will we be glad when vacations are over with? And everybody's back in church? Just saying. Thank y'all for being here. Can you hear me on the back row? Can you hear me back there, Jim? I want to start by saying thank you for those who were here to help yesterday. I won't call any names, except I was determined to be the first one here, and I got here about 15 minutes early yesterday, and Norman had already been here for an hour. And he did the lion's share of the work, and I thank him very much for that. Y'all just clap for Norman. Did the grounds look good? Yeah. Me, well, I was the guy who rode the lawnmower, and Hope came by last week, and she said somebody last night, and she said somebody missed a great big patch up there by the sign. That would be me. So, Cliff, did you see that I missed that grass? Did you? Blame Cliff. He saw it and didn't tell me. Thank you, Cliff, for being there. Mark, thank you for being there. Now I've covered everybody. On January 4th, 2015, in our home, I showed this picture. That was our very first Sunday in our home. That's the first picture. Those were my first words. Come away with me to the town of Caesarea Philippi at the base of Mount Hermon, like Tron or Columbus is to the base of our mountains here, the city of Caesarea Philippi. If I show you a map of Caesarea Philippi, you will see that Jerusalem's down here somewhere. The Sea of Galilee is here. Capernaum's what we've been talking about, where Jesus moved to from here in Nazareth. You see way on up there is Caesarea Philippi, way up in Galilee, way away from everything else that we've talked about. It's the only time that we see that Jesus goes that far north. He gets away from all of the Jewish people down here. He goes up there, way up into Galilee, where there's mostly Gentile people, because he's trying to get away from religious people. I'm just saying. He's trying to get away from the Jews. Caesarea Philippi was famous for false gods. Bunch of deities there, and the primary one was Pan. And I've got, you can go to the internet and find all kind of pictures. I pulled this one down. I don't know how well you can see that, but he's half goat at the bottom and half man at the top, and it looks like he's got ram horns. Isn't that the kind of God you'd like to worship today? Just saying. They worshiped him with the same twisted, weird, passionate sacrifices that they did other false gods. It was still fairly in Jesus' ministry, and he was kind of testing the waters, and so he led the disciples up north to Caesarea Philippi, where there are a bunch of false gods, the primary one being the god named Pan. We find this story for us in Matthew 16. You can turn there if you want to. I want to read through it all the way to the end, and then just want to share. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, we just showed you that on the map, way north, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" He was testing the waters. What's the word out there on the street? What are y'all hearing back down there in Galilee, back down there around the sea? What are you hearing about our ministry? Jesus had been performing miracles. People had been seeing it. People had been forming their notions about who Jesus was, and he was just testing. What are y'all hearing? They replied, you all remember these verses. They replied, well, some of them think that you're John the Baptist. And others think that you're the prophet Elijah. And others think that you're Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. Some say you're a national reformer or a miracle worker or a prophet. And these were all good titles for Jesus, but they fell short of who he was. And so he asks that famous follow-up question in verse 15. But you fellas, who do you say that I am? And you remember that those infamous words from Simon Peter, who was the spokesman of the disciples. Simon Peter stepped forward, raised his hand, and said, I know, I know. You are the Messiah, or the Christ. Messiah is the Old Testament word. Christ is the New Testament word. They both mean the chosen one or the anointed one. Simon Peter says, we know and understand that you are the chosen one, the Son of the living God. Now, remember where they're at there, up there in Caesarea Philippi, and there are these other gods all over the place. Verse 17, Jesus responded, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, because flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven. Simon Peter, nobody down here told you that. Your mama didn't tell you. Your synagogue Sunday, Sabbath day teacher didn't tell you. Nobody would reveal that to you except my Father, which is in heaven. And let me just pause and say that if you happen to be here today and you are not sure who Jesus is, I could spend hours and hours and hours trying to convince you. But I'll say that the only way, Antoinette, that you can know that Jesus is the Son of God is if the Heavenly Father reveals that to you, like he revealed it to me and to many of you. We can talk till we're blue in the face, but at the end of the day, it's God himself who is reaching down and drawing people to himself. Isn't that great? Isn't that great that we don't have to do it? I don't know who convinced you. You didn't learn out of flesh and blood. My Heavenly Father revealed that to you. And so Jesus continues with verse 18, and I also say to you that you are Peter. The word Petros means little rock. Let me grab a little rock. A little Petros. Let me say to you that you are Petros. And upon this Petra, which is a bedrock, a foundation, upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. Not upon you, Petros, you Peter, but upon the words that you have spoken, upon this rock, I will build my church. This rock, my church. This rock, my church. And the gates of hell, the gates of Hades, will not be able to prevail against my church, because it's built on that foundation that I am the Son of the living God. Amen. I'll just tell you that I've kind of given you the whole theology bit of Church 247. If you want to say, what do we believe? I'll just give it to you in the vernacular. We believe that Jesus is God's boy. And we might argue about that. There's a whole bunch of things out there that we're just not going to spend any time arguing about, but hopefully we'd be willing to go to the stake on that one truth, that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. Verse 19, Jesus continues, I will give you, he's telling this to maybe Peter, maybe all the disciples, I will give you the keys of the kingdom, and whatever you bind on earth will have been bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will have been loosed in heaven. You ever read that verse and think, I don't know what that means? Let me ask you the question. When did you get your first set of keys? For me, they were scotch taped for the 1968 Volkswagen Bug. They were scotch taped to the inside of my 16th birthday card. It was one of my proudest, most memorable birthday presents ever, was the key to my 1968 Volkswagen. Jesus says, so when my parents gave me that key, they are giving me authority to that car. And it was probably with fear and trembling that they did so, but they gave me the keys to the car. And Jesus is saying, I'm going to be with you for about three and a half years, and I'm going to teach you, and I'm going to lead you, and I'm going to mentor you, and I'm going to disciple you. But at some point, I'm going to hand you the keys to the kingdom, and you're going to be in charge because I'm going to be out of here. I'll give you the keys to the kingdom. Verse 20. Interestingly, then he gave the disciples orders to tell no one that he was the Messiah. Why would he do that? It's because he knew that as soon as those people back down in Jerusalem figured out he was the Messiah, he was toast. He was out of there. He was trying to hold that. Let people come to their own realization. You don't have to go and tell it. We'll just show up. I'll just do my thing. I'll just preach the good news. I'll just perform miracles, and people will figure it out. Please just don't go talk about it. Isn't that amazing? I'll allow you to read the rest of Matthew 16. I'm going to put Petrus down and hang on to Petra for a minute. I'll allow you to read the rest of Matthew 16 to see what Jesus began to teach after that retreat. Pretty amazing. I had the privilege to travel to the UK a bunch of times, and one of those times we went to Liverpool. You may remember that Liverpool is the hometown of the famous band, the Beatles. And if you go to the particular street, you will find the Cavern Pub where the Beatles first got their start. And I've got this picture of me leaning against the statue of John Lennon right outside the Cavern Pub in Liverpool. I mentioned that Caesarea Philippi was famous for its idol worship, especially the god of Pan. Peter said, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." I've often thought of that picture. I've imagined that Jesus would lean against one of those false gods when he was up there at Caesarea Philippi. I want to show you a picture of Pan and Jesus together. Pretty remarkable contrast, isn't it? The Christ, the Son of the living God, versus one of these other false deities. Barclay goes on as far as to say that it is as if Jesus deliberately set himself against the background of the world's religions in all their history and splendor and demanded to be compared to them and to have the verdict given in his favor. Let me take you right straight to the center of all the world's religions and let me find one of those fellers and lean up against it and ask you the question, who do people say that I am and who do you think I am? Knowing at that point, quite frankly, that Simon Peter would have the right answer, that you're the Christ, you're the Son of the living God, as he perhaps leaned against one of those false gods. I've imagined that. In fact, I've long envisioned Jesus up there in Caesarea Philippi. If you go there, you'll see that on that dome, or on that rock, they kind of had half dome carved out little ledges, and where that little ledge was where you carved it out, they would set one of these false gods. And I have long envisioned Jesus going right up to the face of that rock and leaning up on that rock and seeing one of those false gods and posing the question. I've long imagined that. 58 days ago from today, I went to Caesarea Philippi. Because of our very first church service in our home 7 years ago, I think that this is the place that I most anticipated going to the nation when we went to Israel, was to go to Caesarea Philippi, where that foundation was established like it was we did on January 4th, 2015. You've heard me say that a whole bunch of sacred places in Israel have been covered with a shrine or a church or a chapel or a something or other. Not Caesarea Philippi. It appears as though it was just abandoned, that the city just, somebody just, everybody just walked away and left, and it was abandoned, but yet it was frozen in time, just like it was, waiting for pilgrims like me to pass through. There were very few remains there, but there was obviously life. I took this picture. This picture was kind of the one that we have seen with different walls that were there and different artifacts and remains that were there. And it looks like they kind of picked them up and all put them together in that one little area right there at Caesarea Philippi, just at the base of that rock. I want to show you a 14-second video, and you can imagine that this would have been a beautiful place in its time. There's the little waters across the bridge.
The spring of Hermon River. We're at the base of Mount Hermon.
You can't see a whole lot there, but you can imagine that the water there was coming out of the rock across the bridge at the base of the base of the mountain, all the water coming out. It would have been a beautiful place. But now it just stood there waiting for Simon Peter's and Jesus' world-changing words to be echoed over and over and over and over throughout the centuries. Peter saying, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus saying, "Upon this rock I will build my church." It happened right there at Caesarea Philippi. So what did it look like, this place where Jesus predicted that his church would still be here? I showed you a picture of the remains. I showed you a picture of the little water coming down at the base of the rock. But let's go up on the rock, and I want to show you, to give you an idea of the land, of what the lay of the land, of what it would have looked like on top of the rock. This is on top, looking back. I think I do a 360.
360-degree panoramic view. This absolutely remarkable sight for Jesus to choose and select to inaugurate the foundation of his church, his ecclesia, his called out assembly. Just amazing.
So you see, there's no civilization there. There is no town. There is no shrine there. There is just a bunch of rocks with a rock face. And you'll be able to see more clearly in just a minute the carved out areas where the idols would have sat. So we walked up on the rocks, and my many years vision of what may have happened was far clearer than I could have ever imagined. Imagine with me being up on the rock. Watch this video.
Here we are on the rock at Caesarea Philippi, and you see that in multiple locations there were carved out of the rock these little shells, and in each one of these shells there was a god that was placed in these shells. And I've envisioned Jesus coming up to one of these false gods and leaning against them, and that's when he asked the question, "Fellas, who do men say that I am?" And they gave their responses, and then as he leaned against this rock, he asked the disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And that's when Peter made the confession, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus stands, I can almost envision him standing here, leaning against these false gods, asking for that confession that he was the Christ, the Son of the living God. What a powerful, powerful picture this is. What a beautiful place for Jesus to bring his disciples on this first discipleship retreat to affirm and confirm that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God. He is the one who created these rocks, and upon this rock he will build his church. Amen.
And I'll tell you, just in that moment, having the opportunity to see that rock, see the carvings, and imagine maybe the God of Pan sitting on one of those shelves, It was, for me, that was worth the whole trip. That one picture was worth the whole trip. And then Jesus said, "The gates of hell or Hades won't prevail against the church." Watch what Jesus does in this. This is a 52-second video. Watch what Jesus does up on the mountain right there on that rock face while he's probably talking to his disciples. Watch what he does.
As we have panned around this view that has been dedicated to the God of Pan, no pun intended, you will see here to my right, to your left, this massive cave that back in the rock that was believed to be the entrance into the underworld and to the entrance into Hades or into to hell itself.
And in this context, Jesus said, the gates of hell will not prevail against my church. No doubt a play on the fact that this represents an entryway into the underworld. So amazing symbolism that Jesus used when he said, the gates of hell won't prevail against my church. That was just from here, less than from here to here, away from where I was standing at, where that rock was at. And there was this great cave, this opening that was believed to be the opening to the underworld. And Jesus says, upon this rock I'll build my church. And the gates of hell right over there, the opening of hell, will not prevail against it. Ray Vanderling says, Jesus presented a clear challenge with his words. He didn't want his followers hiding from evil. He wanted them to storm the gates of hell. Church. We don't need to hunker down. We don't need to be afraid of evil. We don't need to be afraid of the gates of hell. We don't need to be afraid of Satan. We don't need to be afraid of the devil. We need to storm the gates of hell with the truth of God. Upon this rock, I'll build my church, and the gates of hell won't be able to prevail against it. Yeah. And so here we are, 2,000 years later. It remains his church, and although time has come and gone, and those people have passed on, the city has been long abandoned, his church continues every bit as strong as ever. It's grown and spread from those hills. I Google searched, how far is it to Caesarea Philippi? It has spread those 6,246 miles to here, Boiling Springs, South Carolina, in the year of our Lord, 2022. The church of Jesus is his church. It's his church because he called it my church. I've shown our rock 100 times over these years. It's a reminder of whose church it is and what the foundation is. So how did Jesus build the church? Did he invite some friends over to his house and have a meeting in his church like we did in January of 2015? No. In fact, remarkably, Jesus wasn't even there when the church was formed. You remember that? He had been crucified. He had been resurrected. He hung around for 40 days. He had ascended back up into heaven. And 10 days later, on the 50th day, the day of Pentecost, that was the day of the birthday of the church. That's when the Spirit of God came down, first on those disciples and then on all of those believers. That was the birthday of the church, and Jesus wasn't even here. I'll get the blue bowl back in a minute. I've shown this over these years. Of course, the church of Jesus is not a building, but on that very first day in our living room, I said, that's the rock, and upon that rock, I'll build my church. This was really a schoolhouse that my dad built, but I kind of used it symbolically for a church. On that day, on the day of Pentecost, that's the day that the church of Jesus that you and I belong to was birthed. That's the birthday of the church. It's what we refer to as the capital C church. It's the big church. It's the universal church. It's the church that consists of all people, all races, all colors, over all time, over all geographic locations, spanning all statuses and socioeconomic demographics. All of the people, every person who's ever asked Jesus into their life and has become a part of the church of Jesus, that's the capital C, the universal church of Jesus Christ, that he promised on that rock he was going to build and the gates of hell wouldn't prevail against it. And 2,000 years later, at some point, the Bible says that every tribe and every nation will give verbal assent that the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. And it's happening. It's building in our day, is it not? When it's finished growing, it will be comprised of people from every nation, every tongue or language, and every tribe or people group, male and female, children and old-timers, every walk of life, every occupation, every social status, every demographic. And the gates of hell will never be able to prevail against it. So how does he get his own church if he wasn't even there? Well, here's how Jesus got the church. He bought it. He purchased the church. And if you purchase a church, you own it. Now, we're asking, quite frankly, we're praying the Lord for $1 million so we can build a building in which we can meet. If you need something to pray about us. Get the Lord giving us. Darla's smiling and nodding. Amen, Darla? $1 million. But apparently the church of Jesus was much more expensive than that. How much did it cost? In the book of Acts, Jesus, Luke has given us the story of the beginning of the church. In chapter 20, Paul is talking to the elders or the leaders of the church. Man, that's a loaded passage of the scripture, but I want to hone in on one verse: to the elders of this church at Ephesus, the city of Ephesus, where he started the church. That's where we get the book of Ephesians in the Bible. Paul is talking to the elders of the church at Ephesus, and he says this in Acts 20, be on guard. He's talking to the elders. He's talking today. He's talking to John and to Les and to Jim and Hal and to myself. Be on guard, elders, for yourselves and all of the flock of which the Holy Spirit has appointed to you as overseers. And I will tell you that I feel that on my shoulders as a grave responsibility to be an overseer in the church of Jesus, because he's holding me to that. To shepherd the church of God, and here it is, which he purchased with his own blood. You want to know how much a church costs? You give your blood for it. You give your blood for it. You pay for it. And God will give you a church. That's what our church cost us. It wasn't $1 million. It wasn't just me showing up freely and say, Jesus, can I come into your kingdom? Somebody had to shed his blood to purchase the church of Jesus. And then what happens? He goes back up to heaven. He's not even here when the church is born. But the Father says, Son, in response and in honor of you going and giving your blood for these people, I'm going to give you a gift. And that gift is the church of Jesus. We call it the bride of Christ. The church is the bride of Christ. It is a gift to the Lord Jesus from his Father for going and purchasing us with his own blood. That's where a church comes from. That's the capital C church, the universal church. It is the largest, longest lasting, most powerful, most well-funded, most influential institution in human history, period, bar none. Nothing can come close to the church of Jesus Christ. That's the big C church. It is the universal church. It is not a building. It is not a denomination. It is not a creed. It is not a code of ethics. It is not some big, loud, strong personalities or great orators. It is a people of Jesus, the church of Jesus. Then why do we have so many churches, plural? There's this little church and that right there, and you can spit and hit that church and throw a baseball and hit that church and hit a golf ball and hit that church. Why are there so many of those? We call each of those a little C church, the churches of Jesus, a local church, if you will. A local group of people who have committed themselves to meet and share and worship and fellowship and pray and serve and then go out and spread the good news with the world around us. A local church. That's what we are. We're a representation of the big C church. Now think about that. We often know we're all part of the same family. We're all part of the same God. You know what? That church up there that meets and they have a different color sign and a different size building and their pastor preaches differently and their music sounds differently and they pray louder or softer and they preach longer or not so long. They are all a part of the church that Jesus purchased. The same church. About the responsibility. Think about when I go out on Highway 9 and claim to be a Christian. And I do something on Highway 9 that I shouldn't do, Brother Forrest. I just talked to him because he said, sometimes my Christianity is tested on Highway 9. Thank you, Forrest. Can I have permission to share that? Good. Thanks. If I go out from this little tiny church, this little local C church, and I do something that would hurt my testimony, I'm just not hurting my testimony. I'm not just hurting the testimony of Church 247. I am hurting the testimony of the capital C Church of Jesus. He owns it. He bought it. Every one of us is a unique church. Why are we unique? Because we have our own culture. Why do we have our own culture? Because we're all different. My style is different from that other guy's style. Our music is different from that other church's style. We're all local churches. We all have our own culture. And I think the Lord just looks down and just smiles and cackles at us and our churches and how we do things. And if we pause to give him worship and praise, he's honored by that, is he not? We see these two ideas in the book of Acts, which is the history of the early church. First, the capital C church. So the church throughout all Judea, Galilee, and Samaria. That's the three parts of Israel. The church wasn't just, it was a bunch of different meeting places over hundreds of miles. The church throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria had peace. That's right after they had been persecuted, and so they spread, and they got to these places, and finally there was some peace there. Living in the fear of the Lord and encouraged by the Spirit, it, the capital C church, increased in numbers. Then just a few chapters later, we see the Apostle Paul as he traveled around and started these little local churches. In Acts chapter 14, Dr. Luke tells us that when they had appointed elders for them in every church. In chapter 9, we saw the church. It was a lowercase c, but we call it the capital C, the universal church. The church spread and had peace. Here we're seeing that they went back and they appointed elders in every one of these little churches and prayed with fasting. They committed them to the Lord in whom they believed. Those are the little C churches all around us. Can there ever be too many churches of Jesus? I don't think so. And I will just say, let me just say to you that we've had church for 7.5 years and you've probably not yet heard me say one other word about one other church, because we are on the same page. At least we need to be, right? We are called to the same thing. I'm spending no time talking about that little C Church of Jesus because it belongs to the big C Church of Jesus and it has the exact same mission and commission as I have. Go into the world and make disciples. That's why our vision is 46,500 people. It ain't 46,500 other church people. It's 46,500 people live around here that probably aren't in church anywhere. That's our target. So what is the significance of any of this for us today? The fact that 2,000 years ago he established his church on the rock of the truth that he's the Son of the living God. I wrote down three significances. The first one is, since it is his church, he has the right to give instructions on how we should conduct ourselves individually and as a part of the church. And he has given us those instructions in his word. Sometimes the truth is very hard. Sometimes it steps all over our toes or runs counter to what we want to do or runs counter to culture, to what everyone else is doing. But since we as Christians find ourselves as members of his church, which he purchased, we live under the umbrella of his guidance and his direction. And I will say to you that it is the responsibility of those elders that have been appointed by the Holy Spirit as overseers to make sure that we are living underneath the umbrella of his instructions that he has given to us in his word. And sometimes they run counterculture. Sometimes they hit us very, very wrongly. If his word says don't lie, then we better not be lying. If his word says don't kill, then we better not be killing. If his word says don't commit adultery, then we better not be committing adultery. If he has earned the right to tell us how to live because it is his church. Secondly, and very transparently, I will say to you that for me as a pastor, or we can take great comfort and rest in the fact that this is his church. It's not my church. I don't always do it, but I can rest in that fact. I'll never forget the first time that one of our elders resigned and left the church. I just knew that the whole thing was going to come apart at the seams. I stressed, and I asked, could I have done something different? Did I run that elder off? Did I mess it up? Is it now going to come unglued? Is the Lord going to bless our church? Do I have the courage to carry on because I was terribly discouraged? What will our future look like? How will we ever get back to normal? And you know what? It all worked itself out. And the reason it all worked itself out is because it's not my church. It's his church. Sometimes now I find myself praying, Lord, there's a little problem down here with your church. Can you please take care of it? Every time someone has resigned or left the church, I'm very tempted to get very afraid or frustrated or discouraged or depressed or angry. And I'm tempted to feel like God has forgotten me or us, like he's left me out to dry. But every time he has proven himself very, very faithful. That he is in charge of his church. He has been faithful to us, whatever the loss has been. Since it is his church, he has a whole lot more to lose than I do. And then the third thing I would just share with you is that because the gates of hell will not be able to prevail against it, his church will be here long after you and I are gone. You remember that the enemy seeks to kill and steal and destroy. He tries to get church people at odds with one another. He attacks from the outside. He attacks from the inside. He attacks the pastor and his marriage and any other leader in the church he can get to. But there is tremendous courage knowing that Jesus' church will be here when I'm dead and gone. I'm certain as a pastor that I don't get it right all the time. I'm certain that I have and I will mess it up. I don't want to. I don't want to be responsible for trying to mess up his church. It's not my church. But he would say to every one of us, Clayton, it will be here when you are gone. The only question for you is this: did you leave it in better shape than when you found it? The culture is putting increasing pressure on the Church of Jesus. We understand and we expect it. We anticipate attacks from the outside. We pray like crazy for unity and protection on the inside. And sometimes we're tempted to deviate from this rock and its truth. And it's easy to do. It is hard to stand on the truth because sometimes it just cuts right straight across the grain. And I'd just like to say to you today, if I may, I'd just like to recommit Church 247 to the bedrock truth that this is his church and that we stand on the rock. And so in doing so, to kind of recommit myself, I'd just like to do something symbolically. After 7 years and 7 months, I would like to retire this rock right here. It kind of came out of our garage. It was going to go in our landscaping 7 years ago, but I grabbed it the morning of January 4th, 2015 and thought, I need an object lesson, so let me go grab a rock. And I grabbed the rock, and it's been our rock ever since. But symbolically, as we recommit ourselves, may I just retire this rock and instead tell you that whenever I was at Caesarea Philippi, I got a souvenir. I actually smuggled a souvenir. And I got this little piece of rock. And this little piece of rock came from up there on the mountain at Caesarea Philippi. And I thought for 7 years we've used this little stand-in rock. But in just a recommitment of our church that we stand upon the solid rock of Jesus Christ, this is his church, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. I would like for us now to use this rock, if that would be okay, as a recommitment symbolically. It'll stay right here. I hope nobody steals our rock. It came from Caesarea Philippi where Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church. And the gates of hell will not be able to prevail against it. That day, May 27th, up on that hill, it was almost as if the Lord had stationed his messengers to keep vigil over this sacred site. And as if he wanted us to know his presence in that moment, watch this 3 second. It was a live photo, but I saved it off as a video. Watch this 3 second video that happened on that day.
Clay. White dove.
In case you didn't know what it was. And then we were able to. The iPhone saved. Go to that next picture. There you see the white dove. It was as if the Lord was keeping vigil over that rock. And all of the passerbys, all of the pilgrims who came through, he would just remind us of his presence on the rock.
Thank you, Lord.
Dear friend, if you are a Christian, then you are a full-fledged member of his church. Yes. Built upon the rock that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, who is alive forevermore, and that includes today. If you happen to not be a Christian today, then it's entirely possible that you are here today because he is revealing himself to you right now and drawing you to himself, just like he revealed himself to Simon Peter. Maybe today he is revealing himself to you, and he invites you to come to him. Will you pray with me? Hope said, what's the message about? And I said, it's about the rock. She said, what do you want for an invitation? I said, I'd like to have a song about the rock. Some of you are probably not old enough to remember this song, but we dug this one out. If you followed Christian music for a long time, you'll recognize this song. Sandy Patty did it perfectly for us today. Father, if there is someone here today who has not yet accepted your call, I pray today that they will accept your call. For every one of us, Father, who have claimed that we have accepted the call and the claims of Jesus on our lives, maybe today, Father, we would just recommit our lives and ourselves to that truth and that rock in your church. In Jesus' name I pray. I don't remember how long the song is, but you probably just want to stay seated and enjoy this.